Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, my dear students of Ajman University, College of Pharmacy and Health Sciences. Today we are going to talk about semi-solids. In particular, we'll be talking about ointments, creams, and gels. Ointments, creams, and gels. Now, what you are supposed to be able to do after the end of this topic, you are supposed to be able to differentiate between different types of ointment bases, different types of ointment bases, their physical and chemical properties. Also, you are supposed to list the criteria for the selection of an ointment base for the treatment of a certain topical cause. Okay, so which base will be more appropriate? Also, you're gonna describe how to put the active ingredients inside the ointment base, how to put them, how to incorporate them. So what are the methods available to us? And then you are supposed to compare between different ointment packaging that are available, and you are supposed to describe or explain the differences between ointment, cream, and gels. Okay, these are the outcome of this topic. Now, how do we define ointments? Here you have to focus on the dosage form. As ointments, they are semi-solids. Okay, they are not solid and not liquid. We call them semi-solid preparations that are intended for external application. Where is this application? It can be to the skin or mucous membranes. When we say mucous membranes, it can be ophthalmic, nasal, vaginal, rectal. These are mucous membrane. Now, ointments can be classified based on whether it contains the active ingredient or active ingredients, or it doesn't. So if the ointment contains an active ingredient, we call it medicated ointment. And if it doesn't, then we call it non-medicated ointment or ointment base. Okay, that's why to classify ointments, we classify them as medicated ointments and non-medicated ointments or ointment bases. It's very important to know that even ointment bases can have some effect, such as softening and occlusive effect or protection effect. Okay, even though they do not have a pharmacological active ingredient inside them. طيب, to start with, we are going to start with the bases, ointment bases, and how we classify them. Now, there are different ways to classify ointment bases, but generally, we classify them as oleaginous bases, absorption bases, water removable bases, and water soluble bases. Now, there is a link that is really beneficial to you, and I recommend that all of you go to this website. It's from a university website, okay? And here you will have many resources. As you will see, lab exercises, including preparation of ointments. Not only that, you will have also videos. See here how to evaluate ointments, and you have videos as well that you can benefit from. Okay, for example, if you want to prepare a cold tar ointment using Anguator, okay, and we will talk about the Anguator later. Okay, so this is a very beneficial website that I advise you to go through. So there are four general classification, as I said, and we are going to start with the first one, who are oleaginous bases. Oleaginous, yani oily bases, and we also refer to them as hydrocarbon bases. Okay. Now, these bases has an emollient effect, Okay, I'm talking about the base. I'm not talking about a medicated ointment. I'm talking about ointment base, and the type of ointment base is oleaginous base. It has an emollient effect. It prevents the escape of moisture. That's why it will age. It will moisturize. It will help to keep the skin moisturized by preventing the escape of moisture. And because it's oily, it's effective as occlusive dressings. So when we apply it to the skin, it can protect the skin from the external environment. The problem with these bases is that they are difficult to wash off. And of course, all of you know that we don't usually prefer things that we are not able to wash easily. If it can accept water or aqueous preparation, it will be with difficulty, and only a small, very small amount can be incorporated. Okay? Of course, if I want to incorporate later solid, okay, with the ointment base, if I have solid and I want to incorporate that solid with the ointment base, then remember in your Pharmaceutics 1, we talked about levigation and how levigation can help us do that. Now, we have here four examples. So if I ask you what are the example of oleaginous bases, we have first, petrolatum USP. And when I just say petrolatum USP, I mean here the yellow petrolatum. That's why it has yellow to light amber color. It's also referred to as petrolatum jelly. So if I say petrolatum jelly, then it's the same as yellow petrolatum. Okay, Vaseline is an example. Okay, see, 100% pure petrolatum jelly. Now, if it is the white petrolatum, then I have to say it. White petrolatum, USP, and it's the same one here, except that the petrolatum is decolorized, yani the color is removed, and that's why it will be white color, okay? And the product, you have white Vaseline. And I'm sure all of you, you know Vaseline. So if it is the white color, then it has to say that this is the white-ish petrolatum. It has to be specifically said that. Tayyib, you need to know that the other name for petrolatum is soft paraffin. Zayki, for example, liquid paraffin, we have mineral oil, the other name. Petrolatum, we have the other name is soft paraffin. Okay? طيب, the third example, after we talked about petrolatum and white petrolatum, we have yellow ointment USP. And this is a mixture of beeswax, we call it also yellow wax, in a 5% concentration, W by W, and petrolatum. So we melt them, and together we melt them, we stir them until uniform, and we wait for them to coagulate or to congeal. It's better to say it, to coagulate or to solidify. We wait for that while doing the stirring. So the other name for yellow wax is beeswax. Okay. Now we have also white ointment USP. Okay. Yellow ointment we have. White ointment, and this is again the same mixture of white beeswax and petrolatum, but here we have white beeswax or white wax and white petrolatum. Okay. طيب, the second class of bases is referred to as absorption bases. Why is it referred to as absorption? Because it can allow the incorporation of some aqueous solution in it. Okay, and let me explain a little bit here further, because this is a little bit important. What I want you to know is absorption bases has two types, as you will see. This is two types. One is a base that allows the incorporation of aqueous solution. So it doesn't have any water in it. Okay, it's dehydrated, but we can add water to it. And the other one is a water in oil emulsion, in which I can incorporate additional quantities of aqueous solution. Isn't there are two types? One, no water, but it can accept water. The other one is water in oil emulsion. And of course, that means it has emulsifying agent, it has water and oil. Okay, so it's water in oil that can accept additional water. What you need to know is this one, water in oil emulsion, is referred to as creams as well. Okay, why I'm saying this later you will know. So the part or the type that is water in oil emulsion is also classified under creams. That's what I want you to know. Okay, so from the first type, the one that allows the incorporation of water, and therefore it will form water in oil emulsion. So it doesn't have water, but it will allow that water to be incorporated, and therefore water in oil emulsion will form. Examples of that, في عنا hydrophilic petrolatum, not petrolatum. Okay, it's petrolatum USP, you know what is that. Here I'm talking about hydrophilic petrolatum, and we have the anhydrous lanolin. Okay, type. The other type, حكينا, it's water in oil emulsion, so it's already water in oil emulsion, but it's able to take additional water. Now, example of that is hydrous lanolin. Hydrous lanolin, okay? And it contains about 25 to 30% of purified water. Now, lanolin is also referred to as wool wax, okay? Then what is the other name for lanolin? Wool wax, and it's obtained from the wool of sheep. لصوف الغنم الخرفان. Okay, it has wax. Okay, we can obtain wax from that. It's called wool wax or lanolin. Okay, the anhydrous form, anhydrous is from part A, the first part, okay, that allows the absorption of water. And if it is hydrous, then it's the second part, or the water in oil emulsion, that allows extra water to be incorporated. So what are the effect of these bases? They are emollients, okay? Same as the case with oleaginous bases. They are emollient, okay? It has softening effect. Yes, it prevents the escape of water. Yes, that's true. And it's useful as pharmaceutical adjunct, يعني كvehicle, to carry out small volume of aqueous solutions. For example, if I have drug solution that I want to add it to the absorption base, then this is possible, provided that the volume of aqueous solution is small. Is it easily removed? No, it's difficult to remove it because the external or the majority of the preparation is oily, or the external phase is oil. Type example. And we will have examples from the first type that allows the incorporation of aqueous solutions to have water in oil emulsion. We have the hydrophilic petrolatum USP. And this is, and you have to memorize this, this is a mixture of sterile alcohol, okay, 3%, white wax, white beeswax. So white wax, 8%, cholesterol, and cholesterol here, if you remember in emulsion, it can be used as emulsifying agent, okay, to prepare water in oil emulsions. So you have cholesterol, 3%. These are melted, and then the white petrolatum is added, and when everything is have melted, then you continue stirring and cooling until the preparation is co-engulfed. Okay, Lanolin, as I said, it's wool wax, and the anhydrous one has no more than 0.25% of water. Isn't it's ish? It's anhydrous. Yani water should be absent. Okay. Okay. The other base that we want to talk about, اللي هو water removable bases. Water removable bases, these are oil in water emulsion, and they are also classified as or under creams. Is an the creams has two things, اللي هو water in oil emulsion, and we studied that under absorption bases, and oil in water emulsions. Okay, so oil in water emulsion is studied or also classified under water removable bases. The reason is that water is the external phase, and therefore it can be washed away. That's why they call it water removable. طيب, this is emulsion, and we studied about emulsions before. But it consists of oily phase, aqueous phase, and a surfactant. Okay, and water is the external or continuous phase. Example of that, hydrophilic ointment. وليس hydrophilic petrolatum, hydrophilic ointment. Okay, and this is the recipe for the hydrophilic ointment. It contains methyl parabens or propyl parabens as preservatives. It has sodium lauryl sulfate as a surfactant. We have propylene glycol and sterile alcohol to and white petrolatum to make, and water as well, to make the right consistency. Okay, the sterile alcohol will give shininess to the cream. Okay, and what do we call this cream or ointment? We call it hydrophilic ointment. I want you to know that creams are part of ointment. It's a class, it's a type of ointments. Okay, is then creams are type of ointments. That's why if someone tells you what is the difference between creams and ointments, many will tell you, oh, creams are softer, spreadable, etc. But actually, cream is, as I said, a cream is part of ointment. Okay? Okay, the last class is referred to as water-soluble bases, or we call it greaseless. Why we call it greaseless? Because it has no oil, and the ingredients are soluble in water. The example of that, اللي هو PEG, polyethylene glycol, is the prime example of water-soluble bases. Now, here you will see a table that summarizes many properties of ointment bases, and I want you to look at. One of the things that I want you to pay attention to is whether the drug can be released from the base or not. Is it going to stay in the base, or can it be released into the skin? Okay. طبعا, what you see here, it depends on many factors. One of them is the type of drug, the polarity of the drug. Okay. In the table here, they are assuming that we are talking about lipophilic drug. If it is lipophilic, then these are the properties. Okay, it will be released well from water miscible or soluble bases, and from oil in water emulsion, better than other types of bases. Okay, so go through it, so that you revise or review what we discussed before. When you want to determine which base do you want to use, okay, and this is one of the outcome, what are the factors affecting that? One is how fast or how easy the drug can leave the base. And we talked about this here, drug release potential, okay? As I said, it doesn't only depend on the base, but it depends also on the drug. Type, whether we want the drug to stay above the skin topically, or we want it to be absorbed through the skin, يعني to be released. Type, another thing is whether the drug is stable in the base. You know, some bases are oily only, but some other bases may contain water, and this can affect the drug's stability. Another thing is the desire for easily to be easily removed. You know that oil in water emulsions or creams or ointments, they can be removed easily by water. Why? Because water is the external phase. So oil in water emulsion or water soluble or miscible ointments, these can be easily removed with water. Another thing you need to consider is the place where we need to apply the ointment. Is it the skin, or for example a mucous membrane like in the rectum, vaginal, ophthalmic, okay? So these will also determine the type of base that you need to use. Okay, how do we prepare ointments? This is very important. It will help you if you're gonna, you know, in the future specialize in preparing cosmetics and ointments and creams. Then you should know that we can use the incorporation method or the fusion method. Okay, in the incorporation method, we may use an ointment slab, we call it, okay, ointment slab, okay, which can be of glass or porcelain, or we can use mortar and pestle, okay, or we can use unguator. This is an electronic device that I will talk about a little bit later. So these can be used to do the mixing and incorporation of solid, drug solid. Here I'm talking about adding the drug to the base, okay? So we can incorporate the drug solid into the ointment, okay? That's what I'm talking about when I say preparation of ointments, okay? طيب, let me just show you a video of how the unguator will work. Okay, you see here the unguator. You see a container with a stirring element here. And this is the container where you put your ointment or cream. And then the device will mix it. And here you see a large stainless steel tank that will contain counter sweep agitation elements. Counter sweep, يعني like a stirring mechanism where you have two things rotating opposite to each other, plus a built-in homogenizer in order to make sure that the particles are really put to small size, okay, so that you have a homogeneous dispersion of any solid particles. So let me go to the unguator and I will show you a video of how it works. Okay, we have this video of the unguator. Listen to it.
Okay, today we're going to be talking about the unguator. It's this machine right here. There's a place for your cap, and then up here is where you put the bit. It's a very expensive machine, so do your best to try not to break it. What the unguator machine uses is these ointment jars that are specially made for it. They come in all different sizes. There's a little one, here's a big one. They even come bigger than that. But in the bottom, there's a little base that actually moves if you push it. So you can push it up and push it down, And on the cap, there's actually, if you remove this white cap here, there's a hole there. So if you have a thick ointment or paste or something, your patient can use it to squirt some out and then recap it. Kind of like a ointment tube or something, but in a plastic jar. Here are the bits that the unguator uses. They come in different sizes and lengths depending on the jar you're going to use. As you can see, that one would fit that one, and this smaller one would fit this smaller one here. What they do is they spin around and mix everything up. What we're making today is we have 4 grams of acetyl alcohol. I already triturated it out here and triturated it pretty good. I have 76 grams of my white petrolatum, and I just plopped them both in there, and later we're going to add some water to it. Altogether, it should be about 100 mils. So most important thing is making sure everything will fit into your unguator jar that you choose. So first I walk over to my unguator, make sure it's on. I take my bit and I take my cap. I put the cap on first and it screws into this little hole on the base of the machine there. You then put your bit in. The bit just goes up the hole all the way up. You turn it about a quarter turn and make sure it's locked in before you do anything else. And then you'd put your bottom of your jar on and you'd screw it in firmly. You then come over to the machine. The green numbers here are your time, and where the E is, that's your RPM. So I'm going to hit the RPM button so I can change it. Since I hit RPMs, I can change the RPMs. If I hit the clock button, I'd be able to mess with the time as well. I then hit the power button to start it. And what it does is it goes up and down and the spindle turns at the same time, mixing everything thoroughly. Another name for the unguator is a homogenizer. It homogenizes everything together into one consistent mix. It's really good for emulsions. At the end of the time, what the unguator does is it'll drop the base down and it'll spin really fast, kind of like when you're making cookies and you need to get everything off the beaters. So there it's dropped down, it's spinning really fast to spin everything off the beaters. So it's done. I can remove it. And once I remove it, you'll be able to see it looks completely different. It's kind of a off-white, oily consistency. And now I'm going to add my water. Now I'll make sure I'm not going to add too much water, that it won't be too full. And then I put it back on the unguator. Just screw it back up there. Change my RPMs again. And I turn it back on. And we'll wait to see what happens when it's done. Okay, now that my emulsion is done, we can see it's pretty thick. It's white. If you have any questions about the unguator, if you want to use it during class, ask me or one of the TAs, and we'll be happy to show you. Thank you.
Thank you very much for watching. Now we'll continue. So we talked about how to use the unguator. Now we'll come again and we will talk about the incorporation of solids. If you remember, we said we can use the ointment slab, we can use with a spatula, we can use mortar and pestle. Levigation, if you remember, or solubilizing it in a liquid, okay, with a suitable vehicle. I can solubilize my drug in a vehicle and then add it to the ointment base. Or I can use levigation if it is not soluble, where I can levigate my powder with a liquid that is miscible or can be mixed with the ointment base, and then I can incorporate that. If I am using a spatula, okay, then I can do the geometric dilution. I cannot use levigation in this case, so I use geometric dilution, which means that I take from the ointment base a quantity that is similar to the fine powder to be incorporated, and then mix it, and then I can enlarge my mixture step by step, okay, until all of the base is virtually mixed. If I'm dealing with gummy material that is difficult to incorporate and triturate and cut down, such as camphor, then I can use, if you remember, pulverization by intervention in order to reduce the size and have the material in a state where it can be easily mixed. If I want to incorporate liquids, for example, if I solubilize my drug, I want to incorporate it as a solution, or if there is if the my drug is a liquid in a liquid form, then I have to be careful regarding the capacity of ointment. The ointment cannot just take liquid, whether it's oily or aqueous, in a very large volumes, because it has certain capacity, and after that it will tell you I cannot carry this liquid, so the liquid can separate from the ointment. Now, after you prepare the ointment, you may need to use a roller mill in order to obtain ointment with uniform composition and smooth texture. These ointment rolls, they have either stainless steel or ceramic rollers, and here you will see what I'm talking about. These mills or these rollers will roll and it will distribute any coarse material that are already there in the ointment. It will distribute it, it will crush it, and then you will have this smooth ointment or cream coming out. Infusion method, it's different, because here I am melting all the ingredients, all the components together, and then I stir and cool until the preparation is congealed. Congealed, yani solidifies. Okay. I can do this on a small scale using porcelain dish or glass beaker. Okay, simply I put the ingredients and melt them and do the stirring there. But in large scale, we can use steam jacketed kettles. Okay, these are like big containers that are jacketed with a steam jacket to provide the required heat and heat energy. Okay, so if we go to the United States Pharmacopoeia, what are the requirements? What are the tests and requirements? Well, there is the microbial content requirement, there is the minimum fill, there is about packaging, storage, labeling. These are all requirements in the USP. In the USP, it says if the preparation is for ophthalmic use, then the preparation should be sterile. It means you should test for sterility. If it is a topical products, then you should examine the product for Pseudomonas aeruginosa and Staphylococcus aureus. Okay, so S. aureus and P. aeruginosa. So you should test them for that. But if the preparation is intended for rectal, urethral, or vaginal administration, then you should test them additionally for yeast and molds, because yeast and molds are common offender at these sites. You will need, if there is a water, then you will need to use preservatives. You have methyl parabens, propyl parabens, and phenols, benzoic acid, sorbic acid, quaternary ammonium salts, zyl benzylconium chloride. You have these as preservatives that you can add. Minimum fill, what does it mean? Now, you know that ointments, in the label, they will tell you there is 50 grams, or there is 30 grams, or there is 10 grams, or maybe 120 grams, because the usual capacity is from 1.5 gram to maybe 120 grams in case of tubes. Okay, when I'm talking about tubes. Now, this label, I need to check whether it's accurate or not. So what they usually do, they take 10 samples, 10 units from the product, okay, and then they measure or weigh the content of each one, okay. For example, they will weigh it when it's full, and then they will empty it, and then see the weight, the final weight, and then they calculate the difference in weight when it's empty and when it's full. Then they will know what is the weight in individual unit. Now, they say, طبعا, the average of these 10 units, okay, should not be less than what is there in the label. And from each individual unit, there should not be less than maybe 5% or 10%, depending on the initial on the labeled quantity. Okay, so it depends on the label and the quantity in the label written. It should not be none of individual units will have, for example, less than 5 to 10% from the labeled quantity. Okay, so the average should not be less than the labeled quantity, and no unit should be less than, for example, 5 or 10% from the labeled amount. Packaging type, it can be jars, or it can be metal or plastic tubes, or it can be syringes. Okay, these should be well closed container. Well closed, see, it's different from airtight or tightly or tight container. It's different, so you need to know what's the difference. طبعا بالwell closed, it should not allow solid to get inside the container. Any solid from outside, it should not come inside, and it should not also allow the loss of the ointment inside from inside the container. Okay, this is different from airtight or tightly closed container, where it prevents even vapor from coming out or inside the container. And it should be stored in a cool place. Cool place now, according to United States Pharmacopoeia, is any temperature from 8 to 15 degrees Celsius. And that is different from cold. Cold means it should not exceed 8 degrees Celsius. Okay? And it should be stored in light-resistant container, which means a container that is, or that the container will not allow the light to damage the product inside. Okay, in the label, it should specify the type of base. Already we talked about the absorption base, oleaginous base, etc. So what is this type, or what is the base I'm using, should be provided. For example, let's look at one of the products. Okay, where is the, we'll see this product. شوفوا هون, it's giving me ايش, the type of base. It has to be mentioned. Okay, so what we are going to talk next about, we are going to talk about additional standards. These additional standards are to do with viscosity. Okay, and when we talk about viscosity in semi-solids preparation or liquid preparation, then remember rheology, okay, that we talked about before. Plus, طبعاً, in order to measure the viscosity of creams, we might use Brockfield, if you remember, viscometer. And also we need to do in vitro drug release experiment, okay, using diffusion cell studies, in order to make sure that there is uniformity from lot to lot or from batch to batch. Okay, and within the batch, we need to make sure that there is uniformity in viscosity and drug release. Now, regarding the packaging, remember I said you can package your ointment in jars. Jars are these containers that have wide mouth, big mouth, okay, big opening. It can be in tubes, or it can be in syringes when I'm talking about topical dermatological products. When I'm talking about specific areas where the application should be, such as ophthalmic, nasal, vaginal, rectal, then usually, almost always, the package is either in tubes or syringes, okay? So you don't see jars, almost always using tubes and syringes. طيب, if you are in the lab in small scale and you want to take the ointment or cream and put it in a jar, okay, I'm talking about jars now, Then one thing is you can use the spatula and add the ointment into the jar, but the problem here is you have to be good to avoid air entrapment. So how to do that? Of course, one of the ways you need to tab the jar in order to make sure that the ointment settle down well inside. Also, the movement of the spatula inside will have an effect. If you are preparing your ointment by fusion method, yani melting the ingredients, then you can pour this melted ingredients directly into the ointment jar and let it congeal there. In large scale, there is no problem because there is pressure fillers that will force specified amount of ointment into jar. So I don't have problem with that. When I'm talking about tubes, okay, whether in industry or even in the lab, then you should know that these are gaining popularity. Okay, these are becoming very popular. The reason why, it's that they are relatively inexpensive because they are convenient to use, better than jars. They are more convenient to use. They are light, they are not heavy, and also they are better than jars when it comes to contamination. Okay, so they keep the ingredients safe inside the tube better than jars, okay, because they have small closure, not wide mouth. There is another reason, okay, why tubes are also preferred. The wall of the tubes are usually compatible and does not react with the filled ingredients. Okay, they can be, or these tubes can be aluminium or plastic. Okay, and they may come with special applicator depending on the side. Okay, for example, whether it's rectal or vaginal, so they will come with a special applicator. Okay, and for aluminium, it's generally coated with epoxy resin, vinyl, or lacquer to eliminate any interaction. For plastic, it is made of high or low density polyethylene or blend of both. It can be made of polypropylene. That all depends on the type of polymer that you would like to use and whether they are hard or they are soft and flexible. Okay, مثلاً polypropylene is flexible, unlike polyethylene. Okay, polyethylene tetraphthalate and other plastics, foils, laminates that sometimes can make 10 layer thick. And as I said before, it comes in a capacity between 1.5 to 120 grams. The filling, you should know that the filling happens from the opposite side of the cap. This is the cap, this is the opposite side. So when you receive the tubes, they will be in this form. It's wide open from the back, from the opposite side, from the cap end. So you take your parchment paper. This is the parchment paper where you have your ointment, and then you put it inside, and then you press here, as you will see here, you press here, and you start pulling the parchment paper so that all of the content will stay inside. Then you close the cap, and then you fold, okay, here. This is metal, okay, that's why you fold it and then you crimp it. Crimping in order to have something nice. Okay, now you might use caulking gun, okay, to deliver instead of parchment paper. You can use caulking gun in order to force the semi-solid inside these tubes. Okay. طبعا in industrial scale, everything is done automatically, including the folding and crimping of aluminium or metal tubes. But for plastic tubes, it's heating and crimping. Heating to do the sealing and crimping to give it the nice shape. Okay, is an heat and crimp for plastic and laminate tubes, but for metal tubes you do folding and crimping. Okay, syringes, okay, they have the advantage in you can eliminate air from inside the syringe. Okay, plus two, you can deliver specific, because you know usually the syringes are calibrated, so you can deliver specific amount of the semi-solid. So how do you fill it inside the syringe? If it is a little hot and it's softened because it's little hot, then you can draw it with the use of plunger. Okay, you know this is the plunger. Okay, so you can draw the material inside the syringe. If that's not the case, if because it's semi-solid, it's difficult to draw it, then you need to remove the plunger and fill it from the plunger side. Okay. Okay, we talked about ointments. We'll talk about creams, but you should know that creams are considered a class of ointment. Okay. And as I said, they are water in oil. It can be water in oil or oil in water emulsion type. Vanishing cream is one type, is one example, and it's oil in water-ish emulsion. It contains water and stearic acid or other oleaginous component. Okay, when you apply it to the skin, the water evaporates, leaving thin residue of stearic acid. طيب, why is it called vanishing? Vanishing and disappearing. The reason why it's called disappearing is that when it's applied to the skin, it disappears. This white color disappears into the skin. That's why they call it vanishing cream. Of course, most creams are applied as topical skin products, but it also can be applied to mucous membranes such as rectally and vaginally. Most patients and even physicians, they prefer creams. Why? Because they are easier to spread and remove compared to ointments. But we know that creams, they are type of ointment. The reason why it's here, because the perception, people think that ointment is more oleaginous, it's difficult to remove, it's sticky. That's why they are comparing it. Otherwise, you already know that creams, they are a class of ointments, but sometimes they like to differentiate them by saying creams are easier to spread, they are softer and easier to spread and remove. Okay, we have another example which is cold cream, and this cold cream is water in oil emulsion. Okay, so the oil is the external phase, and because it's the external phase, we call it non-washable cream. Okay, you can wash it of course, but it will be with difficulty because the oil is the external phase. And another example of oil in water, okay, we already said about vanishing cream. We also have the hydrophilic ointment. Okay, this is another example of oil in water cream, which we talked about along with the recipe or constituents, methyl parabens, propyl parabens, propylene glycol, or water, etc. Okay. إذن we can classify creams to washable and non-washable depending on whether it's water in oil or oil in water emulsion. Okay, when it is referred, when you see the title cream without saying that it's water in oil or oil in water, then you can consider it as water washable وبالتالي oil in water cream. So when a cream is said without indicating whether it's water in oil or oil in water, then consider it as oil in water and it's washable. How do you prepare creams? Creams, because they are emulsion, so they contain, of course, oils. They may contain, of course, they may contain the drug, maybe in solid form, etc. And water, of course, plus emulsifying agent. Okay, emulsifying agent can include non-ionic surfactant, detergent, soaps. Okay, soaps اللي هو in situ, if you remember, في الامولشن. Okay. So what do you do? Usually, for soaps, if we in situ, if you remember, situ method for preparing soaps or creams, the fatty acid in the oil phase is hydrolyzed by the base. Okay. Okay, and this will allow the preparation of the cream. طيب, usually you divide your preparation, okay, or the constituents that you have into lipid and aqueous phase, two portion. In the water, what you do, you add all water soluble ingredients. So في lipid, you add all lipid soluble ingredients. And then you heat them to a temperature above the melting point. And after that, you take the aqueous phase and you add it to the lipid phase. And then stir, okay? Continue stirring until it reaches the ambient temperature, okay? طبعاً, usually aqueous phase is added to the lipid phase, but they found that if the lipid phase is added to the aqueous phase, then you will get same results. You might need to use homogenizer, okay, in order to reduce particle size or drop size and improve the physical stability of the resulting cream. For the API, API, active pharmaceutical ingredients, you should know this abbreviation. It should be added in the phase where it is soluble. Otherwise, if you are incorporating your drug later on with the cream that is already available as base, then you may use levigation or roller mill in order to do that. Don't forget that you might want to add preservative unless you are preparing it to be consumed in a relatively short period of time after the preparation. Usually creams that contain less than 45% of water will form water in oil cream, while those creams that contain more than 45% of water will form oil in water cream. Example, the vanishing cream that I talked about, اللي هو oil in water emulsion. It has 15 gram of stearic acid, white wax 2 grams, white petrolatum, and see here potassium hydroxide. This is an alkali, okay? And propylene glycol 80 grams, and then purified water. Now see this one and this one, they can react with each other in order to form potassium stearate, which is the emulsifying agent. And the water content is more than 45%. That's why it's oil in water emulsion. For cold cream, طبعاً I already said why it's called vanishing cream. For cold cream, why is it called cold? The reason is when water evaporates, It leaves cooling sensation for the skin when it evaporates from the cream. Okay, this is the reason. And it has spermaceti, white wax, mineral oil, sodium borate, okay, and purified water. طبعا sodium borate will react with the spermaceti, okay, and it will cause or will result in the emulsifying agent. Sorry, it's in the white wax, okay? So sodium borate will react with the, not with the spermaceti, with the white wax, okay, in order to have this emulsifying agent. طيب, gels. What are gels? Sometimes you want to buy a toothpaste and you come across tooth gel, okay, instead of toothpaste. Okay, what are gels? They are sometimes called jellies. Okay, gels or jellies. You can use the two terms. They are semi-solid preparations consisting of a dispersion, okay, of small or large molecules in aqueous liquid vehicle, rendered like jelly-like, yani they are made jelly-like, how? By the addition of a gelling agent. What gelling agents do we have? We have synthetic macromolecule gelling agents such as carbomer 934, this is synthetic one, and we have cellulose derivatives such as carboxymethyl cellulose and hydroxypropyl methyl cellulose HPMC hypromylose, and we have natural gums such as tragacanth. The national formulary of United States Pharmacopoeia, they have 6 carbomers. Okay, they have the carbomer in addition, طبعاً we have 934, they have the 934 here. In addition, they have 910, 934P, 940, 941, 1342. The one with the highest viscosity is carbomer 940, because viscosity here is very important for keeping the structure of this aqueous vehicle in the form of jelly. Okay, it's the one that is increasing the viscosity high enough to make it like jelly, okay, or gels. Carbomer 940, see, only 0.5% will give you a viscosity of 40 to 60,000 centipoise. For water, what is the viscosity of water? It's 1 centipoise. So you can imagine how high is the viscosity of 0.5% carbomer. Okay? طيب, now gels can be available as single phase gel. That is, if you look at the gels and you see that all molecules are uniformly distributed and you don't see any boundaries between the dispersed molecules and the liquid, yani they are like one phase. But if you see that inside the gel there are flocules of small distinct particles, then you have a two-phase system. Now, these two-phase system gels are referred to as magma. بحكوا له magma. Example of magma, we have milk of magnesia, اللي هو magnesium hydroxide, اللي هو magnesia magma. Okay? Milk of magnesia or magnesia magma. طبعا, magnesia here is magnesium hydroxide and it's used in the cases of constipation. Now, gels may thicken on standing, okay, yani they have thixotropic property. Remember thixotropic property, when we talked in suspension about thixotropic property, that on standing they thicken, they become hard. So if you want to pour it, then you need to shake it before use, okay, طيب what do you have in the gel? Of course, you have the gelling agent and the water. These are the primary constituents. You might add also a drug substance. You might add other solvents such as alcohol or propylene glycol. You may need to add also antimicrobial preservatives and stabilizers such as editate disodium, chelating or chelating agent. Gels can be administered by various routes, such as it can be administered on the skin topically, or the eye, the nose, vagina, or rectum. An example of gels, we have the androgel with a concentration of 1.62. This is used topically. It's applied daily, once daily in the morning, to the shoulder and upper arms. This androgel contains testosterone. This is a male hormone or hormone that is primarily secreted. It's available. This hormone is in female and male, but primarily it's in male. And in cases where there are deficiency or absence of testosterone in male, the male can use androgel. It contains carbopol. This is another gelling agent, which is carboxypolymethylene. Look here, this is a gelling agent. It contains ethyl alcohol. This is a solvent in addition to water. And you have here what? Isopropyl myrcetate. Isopropyl myrcetate. Now, what is this? This is a material that can enhance percutaneous absorption, because you want testosterone to get absorbed through the skin. In addition to that, it has water and sodium hydroxide. Why is this sodium hydroxide? Later you will learn that one of way to cause gelling is to change pH. Okay, and sodium hydroxide here is used to raise the pH and to get the gelling happening. So one way of getting gelling is by dispersing of molecules in the continuous phase. This can be done by heating, or by cross-linking, which can be done by changing the pH, as for carbomers. Okay, here. Okay, carbopol and carbomers. Here we are adding sodium hydroxide for that purpose, or by reducing the continuous phase. For example, I can heat it or evaporate the continuous phase, and when it's reduced, okay, such as jellies formed with sucrose, then when this is reduced, the continuous phase, you are getting the jellies. It's very important to ensure the uniformity of a distribution of the active pharmaceutical ingredients, API, okay, by making a good mixing in the preparation. Gels need to be stored in tight container. We want to prevent water loss. Water loss is important because the gel depends on how much water I have, okay? And we need to avoid freezing the gels, okay? And now I hope that you enjoyed this topic. And if you have any question, as usual, you know how to reach me and contact me. Have a nice day.